This video is sponsored by Babbel. Everyone is talking about AI now, and there are mostly two points of view. Some researchers believe that we will achieve artificial general intelligence by 2028. Well, others are skeptical and believe that we might be reaching some sort of a plateau very soon. This is the new AI hype cycle created by Gartner. And when I first looked at it, I was like, wow, this is really interesting. Here, they basically plot the hype around emerging technologies and how it progresses over time. For example, some emerging technologies like quantum AI or AGI are still in this first phase called innovation trigger. One of the biggest trends of the last years, embodied AI, is also here, like the new Figure 02 robot that gives OpenAI language model a body. Typically, at this phase, the excitement is rising. And the trick is, in the beginning, it's really easy to generate this wow effect. But what comes after that? Then there is a point at which some of the technologies reach a peak of expectation. When everyone around and the media is talking about this technology and it receives substantial investments. For example, right now it's happening with foundational models, where we have top four companies with the most powerful models like Google, Meta, Anthropic, and OpenAI. So we can say that it's at the peak of expectations, and AI technologies are moving very fast through this cycle, and it's giving a huge boost to other technologies like AI hardware. And we will talk about this trend in more details in a moment. But what often happens afterwards, right after the peak, is that technology enters the valley of disappointment. Now, if you listen to guys like Sam Altman and others, according to them, we are at this exponential curve for AI. But are we really? If we take Moore's law, for example, which is basically an observation that the number of transistors in a silicon chip doubles roughly every 2 years for the same price, we used to see it as a line on a logarithmic scale, right? But when we look at it on a linear scale, we truly start to appreciate the power of exponents. What actually happens on this plot that we are getting more computing power along the way. But when we go back to AI technology and make a reality check, we are not there yet. If we look at this figure by Anthropic, one thing is obvious here. We are reaching a sort of a plateau. You know, the improvement from GPT-3 to GPT-4 was huge, and it's now getting smaller and smaller, even though we invest more and more effort, money, and GPU compute in there. And then, if we look at it as performance versus computing power, it's almost like we are putting in exponentially more computing power and getting linear performance improvements. So that's a really bad sign. Current industry estimates indicate that the computing power for AI tasks will increase 100 to 1,000 times over the next 5 years. We see lots of new AI chip startups appearing and raising huge investment rounds, like Grok, who's just closed a $640 million investment round, and Cerebras is also doing great. But there is one problem. So, what I learned from many years in the chip design R&D is that hardware implementation requires lots of hard choices, especially now. Because now there are two major contradicting trends in the AI hardware. From one point of view, there is a very strong drive towards building AI accelerators as general as possible. But from the other point of view, there is also a very strong push for efficiency. And the way to make AI training more efficient is to use specialized AI chips, so-called AI ASICs, application-specific integrated circuits, where the most of the silicon area is devoted to the kind of hard-coded operations. And such designs mostly ignore many other operations which are typically done by a CPU or a GPU. And this is one of the biggest trends in the silicon space at the moment. The problem is, it's really hard to make predictions, especially about the future. And according to Yann LeCun, if you are interested in building the next generation of AI systems, don't work on LLMs. And nobody knows when the next AI algorithm will come out, which totally changes the way we do things. So in case of ASICs, there are huge risks that you might be missing the next wave. I've talked about this in depth in my previous videos, so if you want to stay up to date with the most important trends in technology, subscribe to the channel. For example, this is exactly what happened to the startup Graphcore, which has been recently acquired. They went all in too early on the wrong technology, on convolutional neural networks. And this is exactly what Edge startup is doing right now, going all in transformers, but not that type. Let me know what you think in the comments. If you've been watching me for a while, you know that my background is in engineering. I worked in microchip R&D for the last 7-8 years. I don't think I've mentioned it on the channel yet, but this fall I will be starting an MBA in Italy. And at the moment I speak fluent German and fluent English, but my level of Italian is like at ciao ragazzi. Thanks to today's sponsor, Babbel, I've already made quite some progress with Italian. Babbel is one of the top language learning apps in the world. And what I like about it, that it's designed to prepare you for the real world situations. For example, after using Babbel for 3 weeks, I can already manage something like this. Mi chiamo Anastasia, sono innamorata della tecnologia e del business. Piacere di conoscerti. So I know many Italians are watching me. Please let me know how well I did with that. And also let me know which languages you would like to learn and why. With Babbel, you can learn 14 languages, including German, Spanish, French, and Italian, among others. Click on my link below and save up to 60% on your subscription today. Thank you, Babbel, for sponsoring this video. So, foundational models and AI hardware are clearly at the peak in the second season of Gartner's AI cycle. But as the chart indicates, what often happens afterwards is disillusionment. That's what we all notice right now happening with the generative AI, so more specialized models which are used to create new type of content like images, text, and recently videos. Have you noticed how everyone become less and less excited about them recently? The thing is that there was quite a lot of value promised, and now we hear more and more how there is little value being generated. Some researchers from MIT estimated that just 5% of all the tasks will be affected, and Gen AI will improve the productivity just by 0.5%. And what's interesting, that the technology itself is getting better and better every single day. But people are getting even more disappointed, because it seems that it has little to do with the technology itself. It's more to do with the perception of the technology by people and by the market. Some time ago, Goldman Sachs estimated that with generative AI, we would be able to increase worker productivity by about 9% and could potentially automate as much as 25% of all occupations over the next decade. Now, one of the recent more pessimistic outlooks suggests that Gen AI will improve productivity by just 1.5%. And this reminds me of this curve, so-called Dunning-Kruger effect. And based on this curve, they are now heading right into the valley. Another problem is that people seem to believe in some sort of AI scaling law, that by doubling the amount of data and computing power, we automatically double the capabilities of AI models. But when we think about this, what doubling the data can really achieve? For example, if we feed twice much data from the Reddit into the training, yes, ChatGPT can eventually write better texts. But does it really double its capabilities? I think not. Another big problem is the costs involved. The costs of compute, energy, and the maintenance of this whole thing. What happened is that over the last couple of years, we went from $1 million computing clusters to $1 billion computing clusters, and from time to time, another zero is being added. And the only thing I see we can justify these costs is by focusing more on global problems like research related to healthcare and drug discovery. Basically, developing AI in science, models like DeepMind's AlphaFold. Maybe finally we can find a pill against aging. I would definitely take one. Or I also love the mission of xAI, you know, to learn more and understand more about the universe. I would really love that. But obviously, generative AI was not designed to do that. Let's go back to the Gartner's AI hype cycle. So, while the technology goes through this disappointment phase, what's happening on the background is that lots of hard work goes into improving it, and also expectations become more reasonable. And eventually, it slowly, if ever, reaches the plateau of productivity. Like computer vision and cloud computing, where we see real-world benefits and a huge impact on business. You know how much I love technology, and in my opinion, I see enormous amount of potential value in here. As mentioned, the first time I saw this plot, I was like, wow. But then I realized with time that this is just an opinion, and technology and opinions are two different things. What you think about something is not always what it really is. As with any technology, it's very easy to generate this wow effect in the beginning, but it's getting harder and harder to keep doing so over time. So with the upcoming GPT-5 release, I don't think we will get any of this wow effect anymore. You know, it's just like with iPhones. There is less and less wow effect with each release every year. But Apple's share price is now much larger than it was back during this wow phase. And now nearly 20% of the world population is using an iPhone. And that's what matters. And what I see is that OpenAI is also great at productizing AI. So we need another one or two breakthroughs to take us back to this exponential curve of AI improvement. Let me know your thoughts in the comments and share this video with your friends and colleagues and on social media. And remember to check out the sponsor of today's episode, Babbel, through the link below and save up to 60% on the subscription today. Thank you so much. Ciao.